kings and the Lord of lords. The one who woke you up this morning, the I am that I am. The one who decides the day you expire. Do you want to stand in honor of my Father? Father, we appreciate you today. If some human beings were here, we will stand until they sit. We do not take for granted the fact that we can breathe, we can move our arms, and we can walk. You are going from beginning to the end. There's no place for argument. You are God all by yourself. Thank you, choir. That song Pastor Bimba was talking about God choosing. Choosing. If some people had the opportunity to choose, I won't be standing here. Same with you. Someone told a close friend of mine, you don't deserve your husband. He's good looking, he's faithful. You don't deserve him. They said it to the wrong woman. She looked at her in the face and said, that's what God's given me and there's nothing you can do about it. So when I sing that song, that He is God, from beginning to the end, there is no room for argument. That means He has not called a conference of opinions. We're making a declaration. It's been an awesome presence today. I don't know if anybody feels what I'm feeling. And I think for me, it's actually gone beyond feeling now. I'm just soaking the presence of the Lord. So we're going to sing that song just one more time. And then we'll go into the Word. You are God from beginning to the end. There's no place for argument. You are God all by yourself. I sing, you are God. Hey, from the end to the end. There's no place for argument. You are God all by yourself. We sing, you are God. Instrumentalist, you can go on a break. I will call you again. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Thank you so much, Pastor Buki. Thank you, Pastor Buki's husband. Hallelujah. My husband calls me my wife. I said, that is a very good way of laying hold on your inheritance. Nobody else argues. Hallelujah. Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. It's lovely to meet you and all the women and men of God in the house. it is a privilege to bring the word of God to you. When Pastor Buki called me and, you know, she mentioned about this meeting, and she said, we want you to give us a theme. I laughed. I said, do you know what she did that minute? She was hanging the results of this meeting on my neck. Because I believe that when God gives a theme, He does things along that line for that meeting. That's why I don't attend useless meetings. And I useless meetings.
Yes, so.
Yes, you don't know. Yes. Oh, God. There are meetings you go for 15 years. You've attended that women's conference. You are only getting worse. Your husband is having more and more complaints. You have not had any progress within the family. Yet, you will cook jollof rice. You will buy salad. You will buy malt every year. It's a useless meeting. But thank God, God gave us a word. Birthing limits. So, I want to go with the perspective of being a doctor and the fact that this is a women's conference. Thank you for that fantastic session, Pastor Wimbola. You laid such a beautiful foundation. And I'm sure you will understand by the time I start to minister. So what is greatness? I thought this is such a broad thing to talk about. Because you can be great in many aspects. You can be great maritally. You can be great in your career. You can be great in your ministry. You can be a great father. You can be a great mother. You can be a great child to your parents. But what exactly is greatness? Now, I define it as excellence in one's purpose. So, excellence in one's purpose. I believe that you were born because of a need on this earth. One need. And God said, you go. So, if you are not aware of that need, there is no way in life you are going to be great. Every success you will have is attached to that need and needs being met. So, essentially, I went to medical school, qualified as a doctor. But, if after I entered the medical school, I decided that I was not finding medicine pleasing, and I went to the Department of History, and I graduated by writing history exam. And I had first class in history. Yes, when they call a lineup of first class people, I'll be there. I will wear a gown. But you know what? You have spent the whole of your life chasing somebody else's destiny. There is no way you can be great. You see where we miss it? I say to people, just find one thing for which God created you and follow it. Is that difficult? So why? Why do we have a lot of people who are available? Why do we have it? Why do we have it? Birthing excellence, birthing greatness is personalized. So the journey towards birthing greatness starts with discovering who you are. So we're going to take it now and take it towards the Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology. Birthing. When you say you birthed something, birthing starts from conception. So you conceive. It is only after you have conceived and it grows that you can give birth. But birthing does not stop in labor world, does it? Women, did your own stop in labor world? So after you give birth to the child, you say, "Metro in charge of world, take, I am out." And you carry your handbag and you walk out. Was that what happened to you? No. There are different stages of bringing to birth. Labor itself is short. Yes. You say, Dr. Lefris, I was in labor for 24 hours. That is too short. You carry that thing for 40 weeks. 24 hours is nothing. So labor itself is short. Carrying is what takes time. Both of them are important. Because if anything goes wrong from conception, you may carry for 40 weeks, but you have nothing at the end. The first stage is the process I call invisible and mild. About the most important step, if I could give you priority. You want to birth greatness. Invisible but mild. I'll tell you what that is. The day you have that intercourse, something happened. A journey started. That journey, except the people who came from the village that I came from, whose eyes go like this, nobody else is able to know what it is. Even you don't know. Some women are extra smart. They tell me, I know the day I conceived you. Really? You did? Even if you were monitoring ovulation. Are you an expert? You have microscopic eyes. What God does is a miracle.
Yes.
Even if you release 24 eggs one day, do you know which one? Mm-hmm. You don't. That's why nobody should brag. God just arranged you and arranged you and arranged you, and you ended up somewhere. This process is painless and it's stressless, well, I would say for most people. You do nothing. At that time, it is beyond your control. When God chooses, He chooses at His own will. At times, His choice makes people angry. Like the story I shared with you earlier. It's supernatural. The Bible says no man receives anything except he be given from above. And that includes ministry.
Yes.
That includes husband. That includes children. So there is no way you can beg God for a ministry. And I tell you that, my sisters. You are seeing somebody doing something fantastic. And you decide to go and beg God. He will save you from yourself and make sure you don't do it. The next one is visible but mild. The first one was invisible but mild. This one is visible. You start to be aware that there is something growing. You start to be aware. As a woman, you first start to feel somehow. My first pregnancy, I was feeling somehow. What's this taste in my mouth? Those of you experiencing here, I'm bearing witness. Why is my mouth tasting like this? The next thing, I started to feel some tingling in some very tiny part. I said, what on earth is this? That was way before I thought of a pregnancy test. So, Bible says, Romans 8:28-29, the New Century Version says, we know that in everything, God works for the good of those who love Him. They are the people He called, because that was His plan. They are the people He called, because that was His plan. The changes that you see at this time are still hidden to many. Except those people with those eyes I mentioned. Even then, they are still restricted.
Yes.
We're talking about birthing greatness. They're still restricted. After a while, God will give you pointers to what is happening. The first pointer to a pregnant woman is the fact that your period may cease. And at that time, you'll be like, honey, it's every 28 days, so I haven't seen anything. If your husband did not want another child, he would say, find me too. God gives you pointers. Growing up as a young girl, before I had any exposure to civilization, my mom would pray. And then one day, one man came and said, this one, she'll be famous. So that one had googly eyes. But did you know, apart from those googly eyes, there are experienced mothers. They will call you and say, hey, yeah. Your hands are white.
Your feet is white.
Your face is white. God sent me some of those. We're talking about birthing greatness now. We're still talking about when the greatness is still inside. It has not come out. One of those experiences was when I was in the unit. I think it must have been about my second or third year in the unit. And I belonged to this, you know, group of friends. And we used to gather, lock ourselves up in a room in Belo Hall, in Uwa, and we would pray for hours. We would just pray in the spirit for for hours. And during one of those sessions, this gentleman of blessed memory looked at me and said, "Hey!" And we all stopped. "You need to find out who you hang around with. Those were my friends." And Richard said, "Sister B, I see something." We knew him as the prophet in our midst. So when he said, "I see something," everybody kept quiet. And she says, "It's the Sister B. I see a great sea of women. I see them all over the world." And I thought, "Really? Regagaga! Shut up!" All of us laughed in the spirit. And we continued to pray. I was telling my husband 2 days ago, I said, everybody left that hall. They went back home. I had got something to work with. The experienced mom was there to show me, "Your hands are white. What is happening?" He released something to me that you are seeing today, how many years later? The second one, I was in a fellowship in UCH, and my campus fellowship pastor one day looked at me and said, "Sister B, I see a spirit of worship." And Pastor Bukumi, as he said that, I acknowledge it too. And you see, when you bring these two together, innocent people who are not really interested in what outcome you have in life, but God drops those hints for you. Watchful eyes will start to look at you. Do you know when you start to see all these signs? It is time to gather people to yourself. We're talking about birthing greatness. Nobody gets to a great place alone. You need people. I forgot to acknowledge Debbie. What I said now reminded me of her. Thank you for calling me Debbie. Another woman. She's my PA. She's visiting from Nigeria. My PA. I call you my PA. Where are my PA? She's my coordinator in charge of Nigeria. So, you need people. When you are in this stage of pregnancy, that is when you need to find out people who are about your age of pregnancy in the neighborhood. You will need help. We saw the example in the Bible. Mary and Elizabeth. That story is so beautiful. I kept saying to myself, one decided to visit. And on arrival, it didn't take long. There was communication. You think it's today Wi-Fi started? There was Bluetooth. Bros, you did here. Thank you. See your people. When the infrared reached from one womb to the other, that one said, "Bros, you did here." He said, "Yes, I don't land now. No be so now." So after I left, what did God say? He said, "No, not say everything is alright, bros. We just continue the journey." That was a conversation between Jesus and John. So when you are going to a great place, you need to find the women in any pregnancy like yourself. You will need them for the journey. The day you have sickness in the morning, one of them will be able to bring you warm water with pepper inside. Don't distance yourself. Now you are aware that something is growing on the inside of you. That is the time to start to prepare. That is the time to start to speak. I say to people, you say you are waiting until 2 days before labor. Before you decide what that child will be, you're already late. You're already late. I hold a program called Mom's Altar. And on Mom's Altar, I tell them, I have already shortlisted who my son can toast as a girlfriend. You are coming with spiritual legs that are like this. It's too late. He will not even find you attractive. You know, there's a way. I love the African culture and what God has given us. They say, that woman has washed eyes. I have spiritually washed my children's eyes. There are some things that cannot be attractive to them. Sorry if they happen to fall in love with your daughter and your daughter does not know God and you two don't know God, you are already out of the list of those who they can marry. And that is how it's supposed to be. When you are getting ready for greatness, there are some shortlists you have to do early. Hallelujah. Amen. In this our land, when you change address too often, you they will ask you questions. So when you are preparing for greatness in your old age, don't allow your children to change their dress anyhow. Leave their hearts in one place. Secure. This one will break their heart. That one will break their heart. That one will break their heart. By the time she marries a husband, she has a problem with trust. Deal with it before you get there. Now say you should write the vision. Make it plain. I bet a lot of women here already do this. Write down what you want for this great place you are going. For the first how many years of my children's life, I had a written up sermon. They have to read to themselves before they go to bed at night. I have the nature of God. I'm a delight to my society. I bring blessing to the body of Christ. It got to a point, I don't know, I think we went to Belgium. And we left them with my friend, and we went to the hotel. She called me and she said, ah. I said to your daughter, come and go to bed. She said, sorry, auntie, I need to do my declaration. And she stood there making declaration. She was only finished there. Finished. The declaration had not finished. She did not have a piece of paper. It was already here. That's what we're talking about building. The next stage, invisible but rigorous. You find it easy. Then suddenly, one day at home, you feel something. Pow! You say, honey, honey says what? I think it has started. I'm saying, we should go to the hospital. We leave us as though. The man does not want you to have the baby at home. But you, because in the time when it was not visible or starting to be visible, but mild, you had read up that you don't rush to the hospital the minute labor starts. So during the time of visible but mild is when you start to read up. That is when you read up on what to expect. That is what you when you read up on labor. If we have many people like you who didn't read up about labor would be congested but women going nowhere. They read contractions by calling it 1 in 10, 2 in 10, 3 in 10. You have no use going to labor ward until you are at least close to 3 in 10. Otherwise, there will be no room. So bringing this home to your spiritual life. What is your timing? Do you have any idea? You need to read up. Some of us want to do great things, but we're not preparing at all. I was at the women's conference in Akure about 4 weeks ago. And Mrs. Adenowa, I think, she said there's some dressings you don't wear when you want to go to a great place. There is an outfit you wear that you look out of place in greatness. Dress yourself up for where you're going. Dress yourself, dress up. We're still talking about birthing. In the process of birthing, you are reading up. Preparedness makes you prevent panic. Invisible but rigorous. During labor is when we will know whether you read your books or you didn't read your books. I begged my husband, I said, please, read. Read what you expect in labor. Only Jesus saved me from slapping him. Because my husband reads everything. You too, he knows. My husband did double glazing of our house without having any prior experience from YouTube. Yet, go and read what you expect when I'm in labor. He refused. So in labor, I said, when I finish with you, that YouTube that you were supposed to, you will open it. You will open it in the maternity ward and you'll be looking step by step what you expect. Read up and be ready. When you are 1 in 10, you will feel like screaming. But when you have read, when you have attended antenatal classes, what happens? You say, because it is still 1 in 10. It is still 1 in 10. By the time you use up your energy shouting at 1 in 10, what happens when they tell you push, 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 pat, 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 pat? You're asking for glucose for something. Preserve your energy. People will irritate you. Now, ministry-wise, what are we talking about? Invisible but rigorous. This is the time when God has given you a calling. God has asked you to do something. Nobody knows you. Nobody knows you. nobody knows you. Some years ago, my husband was invited to a place to go and minister. Being who he is, he entered the place, sat down, and they were waiting for guest minister. They will go and wait. Guest minister will soon come. It was after the pastor of the church now came and said, you know, this man of God is always early. I don't know what has happened. You know, those times there were no mobile phone. And then my husband said, is it me you are waiting for? Invisible, but rigorous. You are loaded. You want to explode. But nobody is giving you acknowledgement. Contain it. Contain it. There is no need for you to get to a place and say, you don't know me. You don't know who I am. You don't know who I am. I still have strength and I don't know what it means. I've never. Do you know, I went somewhere a few weeks ago. And this lady that I went to meet was expecting me, and it was a big meeting. And I went with two of my sisters. So when we arrived, Jesus. You know what the Bible says, when you enter a place and you see red carpet, just go and see somewhere until they call you to red carpet. You get the message. But she said, I did not do that, but God has forgiven me my sins. So I thought, this is the main entrance. So busy. Oh, and I want to go before the end of this meeting. So let me see if I can try this other door that didn't have a lot of people going through. So I told the lady, I said, come with me. So we walk out like that, go to the place. When I got there was when I realized that was not just an ordinary door. Red carpet straight from where the car drops you to inside the church. And on each side of the red carpet were sisters. They were not maintaining eye contact at all. Because I was not part of the people they need. May God help us to not disgrace ourselves. When you are getting ready for greatness, you need to behave yourself. He said, you don't know me. Who are you anyway? Who are you? So I went in there. And I saw that nobody was smiling. So I carried myself. And you know, one of the ladies said, this way, ma'am. This is red carpet. Oh my gosh. Red carpet. Say, this way, madam. So I I walked. As I got to the end, you see, they were not the only ones who needed to learn. I needed to learn too. I had my reason for going that door. I didn't know what I said. Oh, I need to be able to maintain eye contact with the person I came to see. So I had a justifiable reason. But it still wasn't good enough. So when I got to the last lady, I said, excuse me. Can you please contact the PA of this lady and tell her that I am somewhere around? So I went and I sat down. So in that, the heart of man is very spiritually wicked. So I sat down and I could see messages going plop, plop. And you know, one of the lady who attended to me or who I spoke to gave message to another one to another one, plop, 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 plop. And they go to this PA. And our reaction was like, what on earth have you just done? Speaking to the lady, as in, who? Can you mention her name? And then I was saying, oh, where is she? And then she came, she said, she has been expecting you. So I carried my bag, and I went to say, and as I sat down, I asked myself, what was that all about? Pastor Bimba, you know, ask yourself, what was that about? You want to birth greatness, but you cannot be offended. Invisible, but rigorous. The pains are strong. People don't want to acknowledge you. People don't see you as anything, just because they simply don't. Or maybe they're ignorant. But it's not your business to treat them. Not your business. Once you get to a level where you know that this is labor, confirmed, grab your bag. Remember what I said about reading up? By now, your bag should be ready. If you get to this level and your bag is not ready, you have made an error. Because when you say to your husband, please bring me the blue top, the man say, which one? Is it the one to you want to the your friend's wedding in Wolverhampton? Meanwhile, you're talking about the baby clothes. Can you see why there's going to be trouble? Because he's not understanding your language at all. Grab your bag and call your pre-selected birth partners. When I met my husband, I asked him, who am I? Who am I, yo? This journey is long. If you don't know who I am, there's no reason for abuse. Because when you finish marrying me, you will now say, Abomela, sit down here. Let us know, both of us, that I am not sit down here, wife. And enough my husband, well, you people don't know me much, but those who know me know, is everything I've ever asked for. I made a list, God met all the needs. That's it. So, I needed him to tell me. He was my pre-selected birth partner for the vision that God gave me. Because when I asked God, when he started to text me and call me those days when T-Mobile will give you 3,000 minutes in the evening, I said, God, who's this man? God said, this is the man who will equip you to do what I've asked you to do. Ah! So, when I asked him, who am I? And he told me, I said, hey, good boy. You only need your pre-selected birth partners in this journey towards greatness. You don't need the crowd. Even some of them will follow you to the hospital, but they're not allowed anywhere near the board. Have you seen that the weak ones don't allow just anybody in? For a reason. Don't let them give tuberculosis to the newborn baby. Because some diseases, spiritual infirmities are not obvious to the outside. When you invite everybody into labor ward, they cause problem. The next one that happens is visible but rigorous. Remember the last stage was invisible but rigorous. Now we're going on to visible but rigorous. And what happens in visible but rigorous? Even the person who is sitting next to you can see your tummy go when you get to that level, what you need to do is to listen to instruction from experts. Listen to instruction. The midwives are in labor ward for a reason. They have experience in different stages of your advanced labor. They know when to press the buzzer. How many? We need help. They know what to tell you, my dear. It will be all fine. It will be fine. Are you having a girl? Are you having a boy? Does he have siblings? They know when to joke with you. They know when to tell you, come on, do something now. Listen to them. If you are not listening, you will miss significant updates about the progress of your labor. Listen, in spite of everything you have read, listen. Listen. Yes, you can watch labor on YouTube, but you don't experience labor just by watching it on YouTube.
That's right.
You must go through it. I'm sure many of you here will point fingers at people in ministry, at your pastor. But how many people have you pastored before? You are always giving advice. Go to Facebook, you will see advice. People have not managed to pastor their wife. They are pointing at people who are pastoring millions. It's a cheap thing to talk, isn't it? Very cheap. Say when you are in labor, just do like this, do like this, do like this. How many have you born? Nothing. During that time, use your pain. Use your pain. I'm going to talk about pain later on. Use your pain. If you know what happens in labor, you will know why we have to have pain. People don't like labor pain. But I tell you, use the pain. My sister said to me, my husband has walked out. I said, ha, fantastic. He's left. He said, are you sure he has left? He said, he has left. I said, good news. You think I'll say, sorry, sister, it is well with you? I said, no. What destiny have you got that the enemy chose you to do this to your home? What is it? Where are you going that you have to suffer this pain to get there? We need to look at how we look at problems. Look at how you look at problems.
Yeah, that's very cool.
your child is being difficult, usually the ones with a great future are the ones who give you the most challenges. The devil wants you to hate that child. It was, where did we have this meeting? Somewhere in the UK. We had a meeting and a woman came visiting from Nigeria. She said, I practically left home because I couldn't take it anymore. No, it was in the US, it was Chicago. We had a meeting. And this lady said, I had enough. And after that meeting, you know, during the meeting, the course of the meeting, we prayed. We prayed about redirecting the path of our children. She said, when I got home, I called my 17-year-old and I started to cry and I started to hug him and say, I'm sorry, I've hated you. Her child! But she was starting to resent that child because of how difficult it was. Because the boy will not read. He will not study. He was failing exams. She said, once I changed my prayers, once I started to see that what the devil wanted me to do was to hate this boy, so that I would not pray for him anymore. He wanted to mess him up. So once I changed, said the next result. Ah! So she couldn't give the testimony for about a year when we now had proof that there was nothing wrong with that boy. Use your pen. Some of the instructions you'll be given will be nasty instructions. I remember a while ago, I was walking through a particular department and I heard people laughing. So it's a typical Nigerian abrogoke, like those nice ways. And we're talking about a particular woman who was making a complaint about a midwife. I said, so what did you do? Why is she making a complaint? She told me, push into your bottom. The nurse told this woman, push into your bottom. And this woman said, why did she tell me to push into my bottom when I did not know where my bottom was at that time? Yes! You will hear outrageous instruction. They tell you, pant. If you don't pant, do you know why they're telling you to pant at that time? Because the head of the baby is just here. And if you don't pant, if you push with force, you tear yourself. So they tell you, and once you are panting, they are helping you to bring out that baby's head. And immediately after that, it was as though you'd be like, who was giving that ear? Was it me? Because everything becomes easy. There are people you need to look out for. In as much as you need help on your way to greatness, you need to look out for competitive contemporaries. They are the ones who are following you, but the reason they are following you is to see what you are doing so that they can try and do something different or something similar. You see, eh? You don't need. Did you see what she wore? Ah! They will go on eBay and order. They will run into debt ordering. Competitive contemporaries. Some of us have to deal with them quite a lot. It's good to have antenatal mates, but make sure they're not competitive. You know the ones that the day they buy the buggy, they will call you and say the buggy has arrived, it's £789 from Harrods. You know why they called you? To give you something to worry about. Avoid them. You don't need them on your road to greatness. When they tell you that you say, hey, buggy, say, wait, I'm sure the 79.99 one is probably about the same. All of us will have babies. All the babies will sleep and wake up.
Preacher!
Bible says they that compare themselves with themselves are not wise. Competitive contemporaries, avoid them. Don't pick calls if you don't have to. This one is regarding your home. You have friends. Yeah. So what did your husband give you for Valentine's Day? The reason they are asking is not because they care about you. They want to see whether they can feel better with themselves.
Yes.
Avoid them. Otherwise, you will end up complaining. One of my coordinators in Nigeria was just with me 2 weeks ago, so I was in Port Harcourt. She said, she met a lady, and the lady was so sad, she was very unwell, she just hated her husband. The husband came with this lady, said, I don't know, my husband hasn't done anything, why do I just hate him? I just hate him. Then this my coordinator said, I had a feeling that this was not a medical problem. It was not depression. And she now started asking her, is there anything that has changed recently? And guess what the answer was? I was added to a Facebook group not too long ago. And on that group, people always talking. My husband did this. My husband did that. My husband did this. And then every time she goes there, she meets, your husband, Then he goes, this one doesn't do it. This one doesn't do it. This one, he doesn't do it. I give testimony about my husband. I tell everybody how spoiled a woman I am. If you look at my own life, to judge your own husband, they will soon pack your load and send you. Don't do it. Competitive contemporaries, don't do it. The next one you need to avoid, your journey towards greatness. Parasitic juniors. They don't want to grow. They don't want to grow. They're just happy to do mommy, 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 mommy. But you know why they're doing mommy? Eh? They are turning you into what you are not supposed to be. They are putting you on a pedestal that is wrong. They are making you feel bigger than who you really are. You don't need them around you. You don't need them. I'm going to go very quickly onto another one. Maybe I'll jump, I'll come back to that later. Now I'm going to talk about what we call bad predictors in labor. There are what we call high-risk pregnancies. High-risk pregnancies. We're talking about birthing greatness. There are pregnancies that are high-risk. That's why I said, Pastor Bimbola did a fantastic job on that. I have it in block letters. Existing medical conditions makes your pregnancy high-risk. They put a red tag on your labor ward notes. The number one, top of the list, is heart condition. A woman who has a heart problem, you don't just receive care from midwife. You have specialist appointments when you are in labor, when you are pregnant. You know why? Because pregnancy itself is already a challenge. So when you now have heart condition and you are going through pregnancy, you need extra help. When you are pregnant, your body has a lot of volume of fluid and the blood cells have not really increased. So your blood is diluted. And that's the reason why when you're pregnant, the journey you could do like this before, you go. So when you already have a weak heart, you are in trouble. You may struggle. The heart that is not strong is likely to fail in labor. That's the reason why, if God has not helped you, and you have a problem with stealing, and you now work in a bank, you have, as a man, you have a problem with keeping yourself to yourself. God now helps you. They now put you in charge of a parish where you have single ladies. And you see what I'm talking about? Existing medical conditions. Some people are never allowed to give birth naturally because of their heart problems. It doesn't matter how many times you try, my dear brothers. And I'm talking about sisters here. You know what your heart condition is. Never ever try to give birth by yourself. You end up killing yourself and the baby. Don't go into ministry until you are ready. Don't. He said, time is going. People are suffering. Who told you you are the answer to their problems? God has many people. Many. One of the heart conditions is offense. Pastor did not allow me to do that praise worship. So I was not allowed to give praise worship when the guest minister came. In fact, I will not join choir again. And when the rock and only comes, I say, I see three people here. I see you leading millions in worship. You say, amen! Say, you wait! Come back next year. You're not ready. Let's check your heart. Check your heart. Anger. Anger. Pride. That scripture, Pastor Bimbola read. Matthew 23, 11 to 12. I love the Message version. It says, do you want to stand out? Then step down. Do you want to stand out? Step down. It says, be a servant. If you puff yourself up, you will get the wind knocked out of you. Bible says in Proverbs 4:23, guard your heart above else, for it determines the course of your life. And I went on and I read Isaiah 14:12 to 17. And it's quite depressing to see what happened to Lucifer. Every instrument, even the ones that have not been made, was residing in that guy. And yet, says, how art thou fallen? How are, let me read it to you, NLT version. It says, you have been thrown down to the earth. You who destroyed the nations of the world, because you said to yourself, I will ascend to heaven, I will climb, I will. And when you read that scripture, you now see what, why God said, no, this one is not a matter of forgiving him to see whether he will do better later. Get him out. Get him out of my presence. That's why God resists the proud, because they go ahead of themselves to destroy themselves. If you're going to birth greatness, you cannot afford to be proud. See, people, they come into your offices and my office. You go into labor ward. You're having 3 in 10. They say, madam, you're welcome. You say, because they did not call you Mrs. Smith. Because they did not put Mrs. Stacy Smith. Oh, you don't lie down. Don't worry, don't lie down. What will bring you to the floor will bring you to the floor. Pride, it destroys. I have a prayer, I pray. I renew the contract every year in October when I finish my conferences in Nigeria. I say, God, I say it in your back. Because when you become big in your own eyes, your end has come. God has nothing to do with you. One other thing you need to look out for is the fear of labor from other people's story. Now the world goes around story. Just find a nice Facebook group. You will never be bored. Somebody was telling me about one yesterday. They called it Rant HQ.
Awful.
Pastor has been there too. You see, you have company. Pastor, awful. I went visiting a sister and she said to me, oh, do you know anything? I said to me, I don't know all these things. God makes sure that he blocks me from knowing them. I don't want to be contaminated. I don't know what happens there. But she was just telling me, she said, I did not last 15 minutes. She said, I deleted myself. Stories that touch the heart. 15 people in one day will tell you how their husband cheated. When your husband is late at work, you go. He comes home. The man, his car broke down. You are looking. Now you remember story number one. He came home late. Story number two, he said his phone battery went off. And now your husband told you, I'm sorry I'm late, my battery went off, the car broke down. Hey! You put three stories together. You call pastor. You call pastor immediately. You say, I've already suspected him. You use your hand to destroy your own life. Fear of labor from other people's story can discourage you. You are not a duplicate of other people's nasty results. Remind yourself about that. People tell you before you go into labor work, midwives are harsh. So because of that, when you come in,
defense.
You're like, they're telling you, madam, relax. Relax, you are squashing the baby's head. You say, that is what they say, that is what they say. I've already heard about them. I am ready for them. No. You are going into ministry. The Lord has called you. He's giving you a pastor for a husband. But the predecessors before you told you that single mothers are prostitutes. So when a single mother walks into your church, you're already calculating. Say, mommy, good morning. Please, I want to see pastor. He's busy. He's busy. You see why you cannot be great? Your ministry, that congregation, 2.5 members you will continue to have for 15 years. It is not a curse. Amen. Because God gives his doctors to people who will value them. Some people are vengeful. I'm going to show them. You can never be great with that attitude. Is it possible to get pregnant just to show a neighbor that you can? Do you know, when the Lord gave me this one yesterday, I said, really? You'll be surprised the extent to which people will go to prove a point. So you go through labor just to show them. Don't ever do that to yourself. There is no reward apart from the gratification you give to yourself. One of the last ones is overconfidence. I understand this. Overconfidence. Have you ever, I don't know if there's any midwife in this church, have you ever had a doctor for a patient? Have you had a doctor in labor? He knows everything happening. He tells you how many centimeters I'm at. You say 4 centimeters. He says, okay, in approximately 60 minutes and 2 seconds, the baby should be protruding. Most midwives are weary of professionals. They're weary of doctors and nurses. Because we know. You decide how you want things to go. I pray today, every plan you have made ahead of God, God takes it up from your hands. In the name of Jesus. The Bible says, let no man think more highly of himself than he needs to do. It is by grace you have been given whatever you have. There are some things that will exclude you from great places. Your attitude, your pride, your disposition towards people. Who are you anyway? What do we have that we have not received from above? There are people who are bad learners. They are negative factors in labor. They are bad learners. The last time she came, 4 years ago, you told her pants. She didn't answer you. She has a third degree tear. When you look at your list of the people coming in to give her today, you see her name, you say, Jesus. I still remember that woman. And then you say, madam, pants. Even you that you are giving instruction, you are tired. Pants. You go, please, people, I mean help. I just know I can cope with this one. Some people keep repeating the same mistakes. You can't move anywhere. There are some lessons you need to learn. You need to write the exams and pass before you move on. You are a young lady. You're not married. You're single. Big prophets have spoken about your destiny. Yes, it is this sex. Sex with somebody you are not married to. And that destiny is looking at you straight in the face. But there is a gap. And that gap, you need to cross it. And that gap is just to say, Lord, I think I'm going to have to love you more than I love this guy now. And until you make that decision, you're not going anywhere. For some of us, it's money. It's money. It means everything to us. What a fantastic testimony that sister shared. I said to myself, if I leave to South Africa, there's no way you will get 400 pounds from me. Go do what? That brother deserves accolades. The next one to be wary of are partially competent midwives. Partially competent. They are in labor ward, but they're not up to it. You know what happens with partially competent midwives? I've seen quite a few of them. I've heard about reports from a few of them. They are still managing bleeding in pregnancy as they did in the year before I was born. Yet, they hold a certificate. Let's see what the Bible says about them. Jude verse 10 to 13, Common English Bible Version, says, but these people slander whatever they don't understand. They don't want to embrace anything new. They say, hey, PPH, postpartum hemorrhage. So, once you see that placenta is not out, bleeding is more than 20 mils, press the buzzer. They say, what buzzer? I've been doing this for 28 years. I've been doing this. I gave birth to the mother. I have to deliver the mother of the person who is delivering baby. They have experience. Quite all right. But they are not up to date anymore. That scripture says, they are destroyed by what they know instinctively. As though they were irrational animals. They are damned for they follow in the footsteps of Cain. For profits, they give themselves over to error. Some of us are associating with these partially competent midwives. They are your pastors who don't know how to hear God anymore. But they still have the glory of sitting in an office. I'm treading on very, very harsh grounds now, but sincerely, to be fair, I have my husband's approval of everything I say here. Yes,
I say it. Only two people are rich, but I have to respond to God and my husband. Anything outside that, I can only say sorry, sir, and go. It does not take back the words that people have heard. He begs for me to invite me again, I will still say the truth. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
My husband ministers. My husband said, are you happy with me? I said, husband, stop asking. We don't need to know whether people are happy or not. We need to deliver the word and run out before they grab us. Find out whether they are competent or not. Sound people spiritually. The Bible says, do not lay hands on any man suddenly. I say, even you, do not allow anybody to lay hands on you suddenly. Don't let anybody. That's a judgment over your destiny anyhow. A lot of people have reasons for doing what they do now. We need to be very wary. The man who helped God 20 years ago may not be in sync with God anymore. That is why in developing countries, the mortality rates for women in childbirth is still very high. Because some things, we have gone beyond treating temperature with both antibiotics and malaria tablets at the same time. We now know that you can test and diagnose which one of them it is. But if you go to the doctor in my mother's village, they will give you one tablet and antibiotics and everything else. You will have like 16 tablets just for temperature that is 37 degrees. You will go home. You know what they do to the people in that country? They kill them. Sense, let your sensor be working before somebody will cut short your destiny spiritually. Wrong midwifery team. You may be with the wrong team. You don't know why they are there. I read the story, Exodus 1, 15 to 17. He was talking about the Shipra, was it? Shipra and Puah, the midwives who were present when the Israelites were given birth. They had an order. They had an instruction. The instruction from the king said, if it is a boy, kill it. If it's a boy, kill it. If it's a boy, kill it. All the midwives in that zone were giving the same instruction. All the midwives were giving the same instruction. So, sense your team. Sense your team. So people are coming. They're coming to associate with you just to kill that vision. I have been approached by many. I remember about 6 years ago, a gentleman approached me. Thank God for Facebook. Even people don't know you, send message. He said, Jesus delivered me. He said, good afternoon, woman of God. He said, I see you're doing a fantastic work. And I was just wondering if we could join you in this great work. I looked at him, I said, this face is familiar. So I went to his profile. I remember years ago, before that, met him. I don't even remember where. And I found out that this guy had a history of raping girls. And he still runs a page on Facebook. And singles, and sexual matter is the page now. But there's no way to check it. Will Facebook do CRB check? I did not give any other answer. I will make this very short. I know you. If you don't know how to sound people, you will miss it. Wrong midwifery thing. The Bible says, observe them at birth. That was the instruction from the king. Observe them at birth. If it is a son, kill him. If it is a daughter, she may live. It says, but the midwives feared God. Looking at the record, that those Puah and Shipra were the only midwives who were observed to have feared God and not killed a child. That means every son born at that time was killed. So they come into the house, they say, you are in labor. Let us set up. They are doing everything else as a normal midwife should do. But what you did not know is that they have instruction to kill. We're going to pray two prayer points about that before I finish. And I spoke about obsolete midwives. It is really important that we know I'm going to go back to those things we need to look out for. I think I didn't quite finish them. Okay, we've spoken about anger. The last predictor, bad predictor in labor is prematurity. Prematurity. Why is prematurity a problem? Because the way God designed it, a baby should be ready for outside life before they come out. So, if you have a baby before 36 weeks, yes, the baby will be alright. But there may be a few things involved. It's a very heart-wrenching sight. At times when you see them when they're really, really small. I've had to attend to babies that are 24 weeks gone into pregnancy, so 6 months. And those days, when I worked with premature babies, when they announce, in fact, to be fair, once the woman arrives to hospital and the midwives confirm that she's in labor, they notify us. That means everybody at alert. And when you get that blip going up, ping, 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 neonatal emergency and delivery suite, even you as the doctor, you better be crying for yourself immediately. So prematurity makes you, it puts you at a risk of early death. So when you step out before God allows you to go out, you will die suddenly. Simple. That's all the grammar. Mature before you go out. There is a pull these days to step up, step up, step up. People are asking you, what are you doing? There's a great call upon your life. What are you doing? There's this happening. What up from the message you preached yesterday, you can start a ministry. They don't know you have heart condition, though. They don't know you have heart condition. They don't know. And except the Lord helps you, you will give in to the pressure. Because you want to do right, isn't it? You say to yourself at times, they must be saying something in me that I'm not saying. And then you follow. That God spoke does not mean you should go now. If you are confused, ask him for the time. When a baby is coming, it's meant to be a time of joy. But you know what happens? When the baby comes too early, joy changes to anxiety and at times sorrow. Because now, you have a 32-week baby. You're supposed to carry baby after you deliver that 40 weeks and take the baby home in the comfort of your home. But when you have them at 32 weeks, you have to go to the special care unit every day. At times you have to sit in public and be expressing breast milk. At times they will tell you, she's having a panic attack, You go, no. Ah! God, this one was not good, Then it will settle. And then you go to bed at night, you cannot sleep. That's what happens when you go out too early. Then you make people anxious about you when you step out early. Those who are spiritually sound will know that you are premature. God help you if you have good doctors around. People like, you know, your father in the Lord will say, Akin, come, we need to talk. I think you still need to rest for a bit. And you'll be like, Daddy, what am I doing wrong? And he just says, I perceive within my spirit that you have stepped out early. Will it be humbling? Yes. You that people were already calling you M-O-G. You now become B-O-G. Brother of God. For at least 2.5 more years. Can be humbling. You will cause a lot of noise when you come early. When you go through labor ward, go through the delivery suite. Occasionally you just hear, and they say, punch, and you punch and the baby comes. But when you come to the journey, the hospital blip has got to go on. And all the doctors who are working with premature babies, wherever they are, you're in, you cause panic. You treat people anyhow. You make people run. You make people scared. As pastor's wife, you speak in church, all the sisters go, Mommy has come home. You're not ready. Your husband is a pastor, does not mean you are meant to pastor anybody. Some people are just meant to sit there and just be saying, Father, thank you for this handsome man. Thank you for this handsome man you give me. Thank you, Lord, because I prepare him for you every morning for you to use. And that is all. It's okay for people to carry your bag and bring inside church. Enjoy the benefit. It's benefit of being married to pastor. But it's not everybody that will preach.
Yeah.
Because you're not ready for the job.
Amen.
Some people, their husband will be the ones that will help them to carry her back into the church. It
yes,
is
sir.
The woman who will preach.
Yes,
don't say because of this, this must be this. God does not work that way.
Yeah.
God does not work that way. Now, hey, the baby is here. Enjoy the experience. You're talking about birthing greatness. Enjoy labor. Enjoy labor. So that after the baby is here, you can talk about labor. You can talk about labor. When a woman who has been there talks about it, it's different. As many as are waiting for that experience, the Lord will honor you.
Yeah.
At the end of this year, He will give you a testimony.
Yeah.
So you will experience what we're talking about.
Yeah.
And that day when you're having three, then you say, oh, Mama, like Jeffrey said he was faithful, I did not do like this, oh God. Yes, that shall be your testimony. Now, once the baby has arrived, don't forget to appreciate those who helped you in labor. That is not the time to say that the midwife did this, the midwife did that. Are you perfect? If you're not perfect, then they can't, they're not perfect. I am one individual. If I tell you what pastors have done to me in my life. But you know the beautiful thing? I still maintain, I try to maintain contact with as many of them as possible. If you're talking about humiliation, I've been humiliated in church. If you're talking about me segregated and, you know, sent, expelled from, I have been. My family was expelled from church before. They told the members of the church upon the altar, don't call them, don't associate with them. About 4 months later, my husband made this same pastor in the show. I said, Pastor, how are you, sir? He said, what are you doing? He said, we came to buy instruments for the show. Both of them were shopping for instruments in the same shopping. Take rest. After labor, take rest. You know why you need rest? Have you met some super mummies? They have a newborn, but they don't know how to rest. You will tire yourself out. I remember years, several years ago, I was working in a children's hospital. And there was this first-time mom. Oh, God. As the baby was crying, she was crying. Baby was crying, she was crying. She was not really, you know, my client to deal with. But the whole of A&E was chaotic. Even the patients who were waiting got distressed. And this, in fact, I have to confirm that it was not an African baby. How many days old? So nobody could be it. I was trying to talk to my patient, they could not hear me. Nobody, the people who came in pain, their pain had increased due to this baby. So I walked up to the mother. I said, hello. I showed her my ID card. So you know that I'm one of the people working here. Can I just handle the baby? This woman looked at me. Her husband said, so they gave me this baby. So I carried the baby and I walked. That was all I did. I just walked that baby. So, and it was quiet. And then the mother started to cry more. You know why? It's like, I have just failed as a mother.
Yeah.
I don't say to her, I said, don't let this upset you. I have my ways with them. I worked as a children's, at that time I said, I worked as a children's doctor for 9 years. And I deal with children in any state of emotion. I said, no, I'll leave you with this one. When you're upset, put the baby down, leave the baby with your husband. Go for a walk. Your baby lives inside of you. They can sense your tension. The more tense you are, the more tense the baby is. And there is a handling. There's a way you handle a baby. They know you are not very well. I said, so, come.
position that you have. Some pastors don't know how to rest. Some of us women in ministry. I heard pastor, I said, Jesus, I'm only your mobile now. Ah, only me. Even on the fly, I don't know. So I say, if I was not a medical doctor, it would have just been Pastor Nicola's husband, Pastor Buki, or Mobola Jeffries. Ah, thank God I'm a doctor. Sincerely, you need to rest. I went to visit a sister of mine 2 days ago. It was yesterday. And she said, oh, yeah, I was wondering where to take you. I said, not a massage, please. I've had two in the past 2.5 weeks. Yes. I said, I've had two in the past 2.5 weeks. She said, okay, let's go and watch movies then. So we went to the cinema. Some of us don't know how to rest. Don't kill yourself before time. When you die, ministry will go on. Some of us like this will have to rest and continue. The Bible says, take heed unto yourself. Take heed unto yourself. Bear with people. Let people help you. Somebody said, I told my husband to make a egusi soup. He started by putting the egusi, blended the egusi and just poured it straight onto the pot. I was looking, so I said, my dad, don't worry, I'll do it. Let him cook it like that first. Yes. Let him cook it. Whatever is the outcome, it's still a egusi soup. Is it not a egusi? Does it change to something else? It doesn't change, does it? Allow people to help you. And remember, they will not be perfect. They won't be perfect. Are you perfect yourself? You're not. You need help. Receive the help. I always talk about Naomi and Ruth. You know, there's some stories that I'm practically addicted to. Naomi had a nasty life experience, but she needed to move on. She needed to move on from that level. And you know who helped her? The so-called daughter-in-law. Some people will say, after everything, can anything good come out of you? I had my two sons alive before they married you people. The same woman that helped Naomi. Because what did she do? Naomi first stepped up and said, Ruth, I think we need to look for somebody now to marry you. Wash yourself, do your makeup, Mary Kay, Mark, whatever it was at that time, and go out. Put perfume on yourself and go out. And after she went out, what happened? She was redeemed. But remember that when Naomi told them to go, Ruth said, Mama, I'm not going. Naomi said, no, go. I don't need help. Naomi said, go. I don't need help. The other lady left. Who would believe that the same Naomi, who had lost everything, now became one through whom Jesus, well, we can call her the great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grandmother of Jesus Christ. Because the Bible says, when the boy was born, she knelt him upon her lap as though it was her own. Accept help when it comes. Yeah. It's one of your journeys towards greatness. We probably would have never heard of the story of Naomi, if not for that connection. You don't know where the highlight is going to come. That exposure you will have to greatness. You don't know when it's going to pop up. It may just be from when somebody says, Madam, can I carry your handbag? The individual, I can call my best friend today. Do you know how I met her? She just sent me a message on Facebook. And she said, hello, ma. How are you? I said, I'm fine. She said, I see you have a conference in Lagos, Nigeria in the next few weeks. I was just wondering, your entourage, do they need a place to stay? Wow. And first thing I said, for now. And I said, all right, where exactly? And she said, we have a house in Villa, we have one in Ikoyi, we have in Victoria Garden City. I said, okay, it was also the phone. I go, see, for one, I can have a house in all this place. So I said, all right, will you please give me your number so I can contact you later when I need your help? But you know the funny thing? That minute that woman was talking to me, God spoke clearly to me, and God said, hold her, she will teach you many things. Ah! You see how we miss it?
I'm fine. I don't need help. Yet, the one that will introduce you to greatness is the one that you say, Madam, let me help you. You say, I can carry my life problems by myself. Continue the journey. Learn from experienced mothers. There was a time I used to argue with my husband. Why do you read about men of God who have failed? I used to contend with him. I said, when they share videos about men of God who have failed, why do you watch it? My husband said, it's just for the sake of knowing. Now I understand him better. There's some mistakes you don't want to make. It was David's birthday a few days ago. And I said to her, I said, the only prayer I pray for you is that you will never be a usual minister. Because when you become usual, because of what people have said and done, you want to follow what they have done. You have missed target. Remember what I said at the beginning? You spent 16 years studying history because you think you will become a medical doctor. It's a waste of time. You would have wasted your life being an extraordinary person. You will never have that opportunity to recover that time. Listen to me, what? Listen to mothers who have made mistakes. Don't do it exactly the way they said they want you to do it, but learn from their errors. You are to learn on the job. When God gives you a place, don't expect to be perfect from the beginning. God does not expect you to be perfect. Learn on the job. Pastor Bimbola spoke about you having greatness on the inside of you. It is already there. All you have to do is nurture. Is it the day you marry, God gives you a womb? Does God give you a womb on the day of your wedding? He already put it inside. You only need to do the right thing to conceive. It's simple. Learn on the job. But remember, each experience is unique. Those of you who have 3 or 4 children, you know what I'm talking? Some of the pregnancies, it will be like you have never had a baby before. The first pregnancy, you did not even know until you were 4 months gone. The second pregnancy, they admitted you from day 2. And you'll be like, God, is it the same me? Mothers, experienced mothers who say it's because you are carrying a boy, that's what they do. Individuality. This is your baby, given to you by heaven for a reason. You are the only one who has what it takes to birth that destiny. Don't let anyone make you feel bad. Don't let anyone look down on you. Don't ever. Individuality. I tell my people, I say to them, my dear sisters, you know, that precious Jesus works according to instruction. Instructions are very clear. I say, God said, gather women together to pray. Teach, support, challenge, instruct, correct. I said, but there is an extra instruction God gave me. Treat my people with respect. Treat my people with respect. What does that mean to you? What instruction has God given you for the visions he has given you? What instruction do you have? There is no way somebody will say they did better just because they gave birth at a different time. So work with your own pace. Walk with your own pace. You give birth to something too. Don't let anybody make you feel bad. When you birth, there must be joy. So if you are birthing and there is no joy, you got the wrong seed. Every vision, every ministry that God gives is to bring joy to people. That is the usefulness of ministry. If you have a ministry and people are always sad, you are in trouble. And don't look down on anybody. Now, this is for all of us. Don't look down on anybody. You can never quite know what someone can birth. Somebody sent me a message on Facebook a few years ago, at the beginning when that precious talk was just starting. I said, you, Omobi, Omobola, you. Thank God for my sharp mouth and hand. I said, what on earth makes me not a candidate for this? Say, I had boyfriend when I was in school, or you knew me with something. Why am I not the one that will become this?
Exactly.
Enjoy your scars from labor. Delight in the opportunities that God gives you. Remember, you are just a custodian. The babies belong to God. It is a privilege to be invited to partner with God in raising the next team.
Yes, sir.
Shall we stand? We are custodians. At times we lay hold on ministry. We lay hold on a husband. We lay hold on children. You behave as though you decide what percentage of oxygen they breathe. It is a privilege. If God has given you a ministry and you're taking care of people, remind yourself every morning when you wake up, it is a privilege to be a pastor. It is a privilege to be a pastor's wife. They are not your members. They are not your members. Don't call them by that name. They are God's children in your care. It will help you to put things in perspective. I know we have daddies and mommies and senior pastors right in the house. I think we should stop calling people my children in the Lord. They don't belong to you. It gives you a sense of importance that you really should not have as a human being. Because at times you forget that my son, that's my daughter, that's my daughter. No. There are certain ways by which pride comes in if we're not careful. I'm going to lead you to pray just a few prayer points, and then we go. I think I've got about 5 minutes remaining. The one that God wants me to pray about is the one about obsolete midwives. They are partially competent. They are causing a lot of problems in the world today. I was telling them in Port Harcourt a few weeks ago, you see, the suffering, the oppression that is going on outside the world, there's 5 times of it in the church. Because we have people, ministers who are not competent. People get promoted to position because they are serving rather than God calling them. That is causing problems. And when you are not trained to handle the machine, you cut yourself, you injure others. We're going to pray right now. I'm sorry, I don't know how to beg people to pray. Where's our drummer? Is he around or is he traveled out?
As the dew bountiful, the word is so my soul.
Yeah.
every old tradition that people have used to set me in bondage that is coming in from moving forward. I receive freedom. I receive freedom. And I receive boldness to go forward. I receive boldness to break loose. In Jesus' name we are praying. You're going to pray right now and say, Lord, Lord, I embrace your updates for every step of my journey to birth greatness. Come and pray in the name of Jesus. Lord, I embrace your updates. I make myself available for updates. I make myself available for updates. I will not be without information, Lord. I will not be without an update. Hey, 10 seconds remaining. Make sure you pray. In Jesus' name we are praying. 1 Kings 19. You all know the story of the young prophet and the old prophet. If you are not able to sound, people will distract you. They look like mentors. They look like mentors. They appear to be mentors. They know scriptures from old, but they have no clue about your ministry. They are going to pray and say, Father, many times I crave for experienced ears, for comfort. Today, I order a help from above that will lift me up and support me when I need it the most. In the name of Jesus, come and pray. I need help from above. I need help from above. I don't want to do this journey alone. I need help. I need people to help me. I need people to support me. I need people to teach me. But they've got to be the right people. In Jesus' name we are praying. We're going to pray. This is my last prayer point. You are going to pray and say, Father, every experienced help that will detract me from purpose, today I ask you, break the bond of friendship between me and them. In the name of Jesus, pray right now. In Jesus' name we are praying. The Lord gave some words for you. To be fair, I was saying to myself whether we should talk about it in private or to talk about it openly. But I believe that the Lord wants us to pray for you. You know, there are times the word comes and you want it to be something very nice and sweet. I'll read it out just as the Lord instructed me. He said, I want to teach you patience. He says, I will teach you patience. He says, I will teach you to look to only me. He says, it will be painful, that lesson. He says, but God says, I should ask you, but is it not better when you know it is me at work than when you are worried if it is affliction from the enemy? That's the question God said I should ask. He says, but to encourage you, it will be for a short season. He said, but you will learn the lesson. Can you just stretch your hands to heaven and pray that whatever it is, Lord, we do not know, but because it's coming from you, we know that the outcome is a good outcome. Pray for him, please, from the bottom of your heart. Pray for this man. Say, Lord, help him for the journey ahead. We don't know what it is, but we know when you finish with him, he will be better than what he is right now.